look in your Old Testament, Psalm 22. If you want to know where the Psalms are, they're about in the middle of your Bible. In fact, the middle verse in the middle chapter of the Bible is right smack dab there in Psalms. So if you take your Bible and you kind of find the middle and you open it up, you'll be there pretty quick. And then you find your way over to Psalm 22. Psalm 22 is a messianic passage. We are closing out the old year and moving into a new year. And as we leave this old year behind, for some it was a great year, some it was a good year, some it was a horrible year. Every year is a mixed bag, I think, on some level. We're looking forward into the future. And it's interesting that they gave the end of the year the birth of Christ. As we covered recently, Christ was probably born in the spring, but we don't know exactly the date. And so when they were making the calendar, they put Christ's birthday here at the end of the year, and I think that's good too, because we're ending one year in one period of time. You have one epoch, one dispensation, if you would, ending in the beginning of a new one. And Christ is the beginning of all things new, right? Your old life has passed away, Christ enters into your life, and behold, all things become new. And I like that, so I don't mind that at all. If you want to get technical, the year probably ends on December 21st to 22nd. And that's technically when the new year ends, because that's the winter solstice, shortest day of the year for the northern hemisphere. And that would make my wife the New Year's baby of sorts, the end of the old and bringing it into the new. But so the days start getting longer on the 22nd of December. And then we have Christ celebrated on the 25th. And then a week later, we celebrate New Year. You say, well, why the 1st of January? It's really on some level arbitrary. There's a logic there in the early centuries for it, but that's the tradition we all hold, and that's where it's at. So there we are. So here we are celebrating a new year. But Christ is the entering in of all things new. When Jesus came that first time, he began a new way. Not just a new religion, because it wasn't really a new religion, it's a continuation of the promises of Judaism. See, when Jesus came on the scene, it had already been promised. His coming had been promised. Our celebration of Christmas is a celebration of the incarnation of God that had been promised, and with it, the promise of salvation. The promise of a new relationship that could be possible with God. As we quoted this morning in the adult Sunday school, we looked at the Old Testament and we saw the prophecy there out of Jeremiah when he says, "Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Jacob, not like the covenant that he had made when I had taken them by the hand and led them out of Egypt," which covenant they break. But this new covenant is hallmarked by a unique relationship with God. So 500 years before Christ, he says, "They shall all know me, from the least to the greatest." But knowing is known in a personal way. It is a word that's chosen very carefully for its intimacy. They shall all have an intimate personal relationship. And so that it's not merely the prophet or the priest or the king that should have a special relationship with God, but with the coming of Messiah. Joel says, "I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh." So the simplest, humblest people in society, the nobodies of this world, can become a somebody with God. And that God would not merely dwell with you, but that uniquely for the believers in Messiah, those who've been washed of their sins by the atoning sacrifice of Messiah, that Christ would dwell within them as well. Not merely with them, but in them. It's a unique relationship, which makes it unique and distinct from every other religion in the world. Sinners who are apart from God can be reconciled with a holy God. People who have been separated from their Creator and God is at a distance to them can be made near or close to God. Not through by any great effort or heroic that they have done, but by the heroics of God himself in the person of Jesus Christ, to wit, God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. That is unique. And with it, he began a new day, and this new day will continue to grow and blossom until the time when there is a global conflict between the God of this world who has been cast down and the Lord who will come again. And that time is marching increasingly closer as we see many, many of the signs come together in a unique way that the Bible shares that tell us that our Savior, that Jesus that we celebrated last week in His first coming, will indeed come again. He will come again in the flesh, and He will judge the world. Wow. Let's look at Psalm 22, and we're going to read most of this psalm, but we're going to start with this one little verse here that really sets this off in Psalm 22, verse number 20. It says, "Deliver my soul from the sword, my darling, from the power of the dog." Interesting study on my darling. My darling is translated in the Hebrew Bible in many different verses. It's Yakahid. And it's translated in Genesis 22, verse number 2 and 12. Keep your hand here, if you would. Maybe put your bulletin or something in there. And go over to Genesis 22. Because this is an important theological fact. Genesis chapter number 22. We're in Psalm 22. We're going back to Genesis 22. In Genesis 22, it says of Abraham, in verse number 2, and he said, "Take now thy son, thine only son Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah." Now, notice where it says, "thine only son Isaac." That's translating the same word, Yachid. Now, it's translating the word that's darling. But we know Isaac isn't Abraham's only son, is he? I mean, after all, Isaac has an older brother named Ishmael. He's a half-brother. So why would the Bible say only son? Look down a little further to verse number 12. And he said, "Lay not thy hand upon the lad, neither do thou any harm unto him. For now I see that thou fearest God, seeing thou hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, from me." Same word translated. In verse number 16, "And said, by myself have I sworn, saith the Lord, for behold, because thou hast done this thing, and hast not withheld thy son, thine only son." This is a unique thing. This unique son, because he had an older son. Isaac had an older brother, Ishmael, but Ishmael was not the son of the promise. He was the son of frustration. He was the child born out of Abraham and Sarah's lack of faith, not of their faith. You see, Sarah says, "Go into my handmaiden Hagar and have a son. Fulfill God's promise this way. I'm impatient. I'm tired of waiting." And Ishmael was born. But he was not the son of the promise. In this precious son, Isaac, that was born, he was born out of the miracle of God. And he was unique because he was the son of promise. That is detailed in the New Testament when the Apostle Paul compares the son of the flesh to the son of the promise, and how the son of the flesh shall have no inheritance with the son of the promise. We read through the scriptures and we'll see Isaac is, in fact, distinctly different than Ishmael, even though Ishmael is petitioned by Abraham and given a blessing anyway and sent out. But Isaac is the son of God's promise and of their faith. They named him Isaac because his mother laughed at the promise. She said, "I'm well into menopause. I'm an old woman, and this is an old man. How can we have a son? It would be impossible. It would be miraculous." Isaac was the son of promise, and that he is called his only son in the sense that nobody else matters, because this is the chosen son. This is the unique child of promise. Now, if you wanted to take the time later and you're taking notes, this is translated in Judges chapter 11, verse 34, Proverbs 4, 3, Jeremiah 6, 26, Amos 8, 10, and Zechariah 12, 10. All translated only son, in the sense a unique son, in the sense that this is the one who will inherit from his father. It is a word chosen to speak to a unique designation. And what is very interesting is that the tradition in the Old Testament is that the oldest son would inherit from the father. And yet, of Isaac and Ishmael, God chose Isaac, the younger, because he was the son of promise, to inherit the bulk of his inheritance, to inherit the promises, to inherit the promise to bring forth the Savior of the world, the Messiah. And God did it again with Isaac's sons. Isaac had Esau and Jacob, and God chose the younger to inherit the blessing of his work in this world. He would do it again. He chose Joseph from Rachel instead of Leah to save the people of Israel and to preserve them in the land of Egypt. And God had made many of these choices, but in these choices, it's a child of the promise. And Jesus Christ is the unique Son of God. The Bible says in the most famous verse in the Bible, John 3:16, says something very special, doesn't it? What does it say? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. In this designation, only begotten Son, doesn't mean that Jesus was created. His body was created, but Jesus is the eternal God in the flesh. And in this, he is unique, for Jesus is the Son of promise. His mother conceived in a miraculous way, just as Isaac had been conceived in a miraculous way, for the Father of all creation gave a promise. And the sinless Son of God, the second Adam, was created a body, but he himself had entered into that body. He existed beforehand. Jesus has always been existed. Now, like the Jehovah's Witness would say that Jesus was the first of all creation in the sense that God created Jesus first and then everything else. No. Jesus is the creator himself. The Bible says, in him we live and move and have our being, though he be not far from every one of us, that Jesus, in him we exist. We exist because of him. That he is the eternal Son of God. And the child of the promise, in that he is unique and he is the one who will inherit all things. And through him we are saved. That is important in understanding our passage in Psalm chapter number 22. Because the word translated darling means this unique one, this one who is the affection of his father, the one who is the unique inheritor, the one who is chosen to inherit all things from the father. And in this passage, we see a very clear prophetic speaking of Messiah. In verses number 1 and 2, we see the frustrated cry of Messiah in the illusion of abandonment. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me and from the words of my roaring? David is speaking in this psalm as a prophet. He is speaking at a prophet, and the Spirit of Jesus Christ is speaking through David to all the people who will hear. See, these things never fully match up with David's own experience. But they speak to Messiah's experience. And we see, of course, the famous verse, my God, why hast thou forsaken me, is what Christ felt when he hung there on the cross. And the Bible says, he who knew no sin became sin for us. That he felt this abandonment of the Father. The Bible says the Father turned his head away, turned his eyes away from the Son for a moment as his Son became sin for us. The epistles say that Christ, hanging on the cross, becoming sin, nailed our sin to the cross and broke down the wall of partition between you and your God. But oh, Christ is frustrated with his cry. My God, verse 2, oh my God, I cry in the daytime, but thou hearest not, and in the night season, and am not silent. Isn't it good to know that when you're going through a rough patch in your life, when your girl leaves you, guy, you lose your job, nobody seems to understand you, when you're frustrated as you can be and you wonder where God is, when things happen to you you feel you really don't deserve, when you cry out in the night and you wonder, God, do you even care? But you're not alone in these feelings. It doesn't mean that God doesn't care. Verses 3 through 5, we see the foundational truths of God's character, the refreshing of history when the future seems dark and uncertain. Verse 3, but thou art holy, and thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. Our fathers trusted in thee, they trusted, and thou didst deliver them. They cried unto thee, and were delivered. They trusted in thee, and were not confounded. That means they weren't disappointed. Because when you're in a place where you are frustrated and you're crying, you feel the illusionment that you've been abandoned by God. It is good to go back and remember some truths. You go back and remember your forefathers and the things that God has done in the lives of other people. And perhaps even in your own life, you can remember what God had done and that he was real in those times. And you can remember that they were sinners like you. They were people just like you, and yet God came through for them. But it's not always easy when you're in the middle of trouble and trial, is it? When you're in the middle of heartbreak, you can be very, very confused. Your mind can play tricks on you, and that old devil will whisper things in your ear. You're no good. God doesn't love you. You're not worthy of it. You don't deserve to be heard. That old devil will talk you down. And if the devil doesn't, you'll talk yourself down sometimes. Self-talk can be incredibly destructive. So you go back and you remember some truths, the foundational truths of God's character. Verses 6 through 8, you'll find that there's fair weather frenemies. Fair weather frenemies might abandon you. The careless, condescending spirit of jealous mockers. Verses 6 through 8, it says, but I am a worm and no man, a reproach of men, despised of the people. All they that see me laugh me to scorn. They shoot out the lip, they shake their head, saying, he trusted on the Lord, he trusted in Yahweh, that he would deliver him. Let him deliver him, seeing he delighted in him. Oh, those fair weather frenemies, you know, Jesus came unto his own received him not. You can identify with that as well. Sometimes you have Job experiences like Jesus, and the people you depend on to help you in your darkest hour, they're not there. They don't answer the phone, they don't answer your texts. Everybody's too busy in their own lives to bother with you, but the worst is when they actually mock you. People you thought were your friends when you really need it really come through and they just pour salt in the wound. Well, you're getting what you deserve. Well, Jesus, this is clearly an example of Christ as he's on the cross. The Bible says his own came to him, and they were walking past him, and the Bible says they shook their head at him, they spit on him, they mocked him. The jealous ones from the Pharisees said, hey, he trusted in God, let God deliver him. Oh, he's in the hands of the Romans now. If he's such a magician, if he's such a close friend of God, let's see if God will get him off the cross. He says, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, through his tongue is swollen, his parched. Throughout his mouth, his body is dehydrating, is losing blood, and he's there in the early heat of late spring. His limbic system is going crazy, and they think, oh, he's crying out to Elijah. Let's see if Elijah's going to come and help him. Nobody came to rescue that good man. Nobody came to rescue that good man, even the betrayer of Christ. Judas, before he went and hung himself, he said, I have betrayed a good man. His shame and his grief overwhelmed him, but he recognized after he did it that he had betrayed a good man. And the soldiers that stood on either side of Christ and watched and guarded his body and the bodies of the others hanging on the cross to make sure nobody tried to rescue them. When Jesus gave up the ghost and the earth quaked and the night in the middle of the day at 12, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, it's just dark. Even the pagans looked and said, truly, this is a son of the gods. Can you imagine the feeling that Jesus was experiencing as he hung on the cross and the people that he loved so much? The people he cried over Jerusalem said, I have longed to gather you to myself as a mother, her chicks. A mother hen, her chicks, and you would not. You're just so stubborn and hard-headed, you just wouldn't listen. And here they are, they're mocking him to the point where they just have no idea what they are doing. The pain for being misunderstood. Verses 9 and 10, we see the foreshadowing nature of Messiah's relationship to Yahweh. I want you to notice as you read these verses, there's no conversion or to become special in their relationship, but Messiah doesn't just wake up and choose to make the Lord his God. It's a special nature, the foreshadowing of the relationship between Yahweh. It says, but thou art he that took me out of the womb. Thou didst make me hope when I was on my mother's breasts. I was cast upon thee from the womb. Thou art my God from my mother's belly. Messiah did not enter into a unique relationship with God. From the very moment of his conception, he had a unique relationship to God. And that's to be contrasted with you and I. God may call you from your mother's womb to service in him. He has a plan for your life. But all of us, as we covered this morning in Psalm 51 in the Adult Bible School, we are born sinful by nature. And when we reach a certain age, we will sin. Can't help ourselves, it's our nature. But Christ is unique in being the second Adam because the first Adam had no sin and became a sinner. The second Adam, Jesus Christ, was made without sin but made under the law. And the Bible says, he who knew no sin, Jesus was sinless. He lived his entire life and maintained a perfect state of perfection and obedience before the Father. Can you imagine? He is, in fact, unique. He is unique because he is the unique Son of God, and he, unlike us, did not enter in or choose a relationship with God. had that unique relationship from his mother's womb. You and I, we all have to get to the place in our lives where we know that we've sinned. We get to an age where we recognize the difference between right and wrong, and we end up choosing wrong. We learn to lie, we learn to cheat, we learn to steal, we learn to covet. We learn lust. It just kind of rises up within us, and we learn to pursue these things. And our sinfulness will catch up with us on the day of judgment if we don't get forgiven. See, all of us must be confronted with our sin, and at a certain point, we have to make a decision to enter into a relationship with God. And it is a relationship that God has made possible. He has opened the door for us to come into Him, but you have to choose to walk through that door. You have to repent and turn toward Christ, to turn toward God and receive the gift of salvation. But you see, Jesus was unique. He did not have to turn toward God. He was oriented toward the Father from His conception, from the womb. He stood in perfect relations with the Father every day of His life. He was chosen and ordained Messiah, and unique in this, for He was foreshadowed and He was told of long before He came. And isn't it good to know that in the light of that truth, that there is a second coming foreshadowed as well, that He has not simply left this world after the resurrection and abandoned us? The very promise that He came the first time being fulfilled is good for us to have faith in God's promise that He will come again. God has not abandoned His people in this world that there should be no justice. For the just one will return, and the down payment of that promise to the believer is the Holy Spirit that He will put in you when you believe, when you are resurrected yourself and born again. The Holy Spirit of Jesus Christ will live inside of you and testify to you of His truth and testify to you that He will come again. Verses 11 and 13, the flogging by the ignorant beasts. The flogging by the ignorant beasts. 11 through 13, be not far from me, the prophet says, for trouble is near. For there is none to help. Many bulls have compassed me. Strong bulls of Bashan have beset me round. They gaped upon me with their mouths as a ravening and roaring lion. You think of the foreshadowing here of Jesus' time at the Praetorium when they took Him, and they mocked Him, and they yelled at Him, and they took the cat of nine tails, they took the scourge, the whip, and they tore into His flesh. Like brute beasts, they tore into the Messiah of the world, the Creator God in the flesh, the man who is the Prince of Peace, the man who Himself was gentle all the days of His life and gracious, forgiving people their sins, healing their wounds, ministering, sacrificing of His time and His energy every single day. Which of His crimes did they crucify Him for? His time imprisoned and beaten was for what reason? He who was born King of the Jews? Was it not said there of His conviction that He is King of the Jews? They put above His head on a cross the charges of His conviction, just as they had the two other crosses beside Him. Because everybody coming by needed to see why these men were being crucified. We had murderers and thieves on either side of Jesus. And there, the man in the middle's crime was this: King of the Jews. Last week, we explored the frankincense gift of the Magi who came, and the gift was all about the presence of God coming near to us, representing the presence of God coming near to us in the King of the Jews. We have come to worship He who was born King of the Jews. Not someone who would be anointed and crowned King of the Jews, but this was a unique chosen one of God. In His anointing, He was selected King of the Jews by the Almighty Himself. And at the end of His life, the charges over His head were just that: King of the Jews. There was a Herod at His birth that tried to exterminate Him, who was born King of the Jews, and at His death, Pilate and Herod became friends over the extermination of the King of the Jews. He was more than King of the Jews, He was King of the world. Is He King of your life? These wild beasts are coming and gaping around Him and roaring around Him, and the Bible says they have no idea what they're doing. As Jesus hung on the cross and these mockers filled the cup of wrath against themselves, Jesus cried out to the Father, "Forgive them. These stupid beasts, they have no idea what they're doing." Can you imagine the grace that's in the heart of Christ that He prays for these people who are treating Him the way that they're treating Him? They're treating the King of Glory the way that they are treating Him. They are disrespecting Him. I suspect if He had not prayed the Father, the heavy hand of judgment may have come down immediately. And yet the prayer of Christ stayed the hand of judgment as He prayed, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. They know not what they do." The flogging by the ignorant beast is followed by the futility or fragility of Messiah's humanity. Verses 14 and 15. "I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It melteth in the midst of my bowels. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaveth to my jaws. And thou hast brought me into the dust of death." Poured out like water, meaning he's wasted like something of little value. His bones are out of joint. The painfulness of the crucifixion, doctors, forensic, forensicists tell us that the crucifixion was a terrible, brutal way to die, that you could often hang there for days before you die. And of course, Jesus had been beaten viciously and was bleeding profusely, losing a good deal of blood. And with that, we have dehydration. The Bible says, the tongue is cleaving to my jaw. And Christ could barely speak, so much so that they wanted to put hyssop and vinegar on a sponge with the painkiller he denied, but later he took the vinegar, and that was just to wet his mouth just enough so he could say his final words, "Tetelion, it is finished." The agony as he lost that blood and as he hung on the cross, they tell us that the brutality is that while you're hanging there, the weight of your own body pulls your joints out of place. Out of the sockets, your bones get pulled out of place. And that if they don't tie your arms to the cross, that often you will find yourself over the course of days in a lot of trouble. These men probably didn't have themselves tied to the cross because they weren't going to be hanging there for days because of the holiday. It says without it, the weight of your body would flood your lungs. Basically, your lungs would fill up with fluid as your lungs are stretched and the weight of your body is there, and you'll drown in your own fluids. And when they came by to break Christ's legs, like they did the other two, because it was a holiday, they wanted these guys to die quickly. The reason they did that is they broke the legs of the two other thieves so they couldn't hold themselves up anymore with their feet on the cross. And the weight of their own body would hyperextend their lungs, and the lungs would fill up with water, and over the next hour or two, they would drown, not being able to breathe. It was just a brutal, cruel way to die. And coming to Jesus, the Bible says all his joints, his bones were out of joint, but the Bible says not a bone was broken, as a prophecy. And so when they saw that Christ had appeared to be dead, they made sure by taking a spear, and they went up under his ribs, not through his ribs, up under his ribs as a skilled executioner would. With a long spear, the spear was probably somewhere between 10 and 12 feet long, with a head on it about like that. And the idea of a sharp two-edged was to poke up under there. And how did they know that he was going to be dead for sure? The executioners, who had practiced, watch the water and the blood roll down the spear. That meant that they had pierced the pericardic sac that wraps around the heart. If that is pierced, you cannot live. So they pierced the heart, and the water is the fluid around the heart that ran down there. It was impossible for Christ to live. These executioners, these professionals, knew that they had executed their job and that there would be no mistake. He was dead. So instead of breaking his bones and letting him drown in his own fluids, they pierced his side and pierced his heart. Oh, but I tell you, long before he had given up the ghost, these people who rejected him had pierced his heart already. Severe discouragement is portrayed in this passage. You know, severe discouragement is, it's depression. Depression is a bout of severe discouragement. Strength has become brittle or frail, and dehydration to the point of death. Deep thirst, it says, to the dust of death. Deep thirst and dehydration. Deep thirst, being unsatisfied. Verses 16 through 18, we see the felonious assault of the uncircumcised. For dogs have compassed me, verse 16. The assembly of the wicked have enclosed me. They pierced my hands and my feet. Did that ever happen to David? No. The dog is an unclean animal. In the Jewish thinking, one of the things that caused it to be a great curse that Jezebel would be eaten by dogs was they were unclean animals. They just roamed the street. People didn't really keep them as pets back then. They're just wild animals that would roam the streets and eat trash and garbage, and they would eat unclean things. When Jezebel was cast out of the window and her body was broken on the sidewalk, and the dogs came like a pack of wild animals, they came and consumed her. That was a judgment of God saying he disapproved of her. And in her death, he more or less spit on her life. And here, Christ is likening the unclean ones. This is a sign that Jesus would be surrounded by unsaved people or uncircumcised Gentiles, pagans. It says, they have pierced my hands and my feet. That's interesting, because this is very specific and is very accurate. The Jews may have cried out in the theater, "Crucify him, this man is not fit to live." But who drove the nails into Christ's hands and his feet, nailing him to a tree? The Gentiles did. The Gentiles nailed him to the cross. They held the steel spike and they pierced the hammer right through his wrists, where the arm meets the hand, right through his feet, The dogs have compassed me, they pierced my hands and my feet. How specific is that? It's amazing. And what that's significant of is both Jew and Gentile are Christ killers. It is not good or fair that any Christian should run around going, Jews, you're Christ killers. No. The Bible says we put him on the cross. Not merely Jewish folks, but Gentiles as well. All humans, all sinners put him on the cross, whether it was those that cried out for his crucifixion or those who executed his crucifixion. We are all guilty of the body and blood of Christ. Our sins put him there. Our sins were nailed to the cross. And it is our sins that die with him. And you can be resurrected with him if you put your trust in him. Oh, there was a felonious assault of the uncircumcised, the unclean ones, shamed him and humiliated him. They parted his garments, the Bible says in verse number 18. In verse 17, I may tell all my bones, they look and stare upon me, he is naked, they part my garments among them, they cast lots for my vesture, they gambled on his clothes as they were nothing. And they left him there hanging on the cross, naked and ashamed. Now Christ had nothing to be ashamed of because he was guilty of absolutely nothing. It was our shame that he bore. You'll remember that in the garden, Adam and Eve were naked and they were not ashamed, but when they sinned, then they felt shame and felt the need to cover up. Even the Indians in the remotest parts of South America in the jungles, they cover one part up. They might run around topless, but there's one part that gets covered up. Even among those who have been isolated for thousands and thousands of years in the hottest part of the jungle where it's just miserable to wear clothes because it's so stinking hot and humid, they cover one part up. And Jesus, in his purity and innocency, bore no shame of his own, but he bore our shame. Isaiah prophesied of this. He who knew no sins became sin for us. Yes, the Bible says, all we like sheep have gone astray, but the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. We considered him despised and rejected of God, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, but it was for our sins, our transgressions, it's our shame that was upon him. David, 1,000 years before Christ, prophesies of Messiah. They part my garments and they cast lots. They gamble for my clothes. Verses 19 through 21, where our initial text verse was, the faith of Messiah endures through the ultimate injustice. The faith of Messiah, his faith in God, his faith in his mission endures through the ultimate injustice. Verse 19, but be thou not far from me, O Lord. O, my strength, haste to help me. Deliver my soul from the sword. My darling, from the power of the dog, your unique son, the one who is the Father's unique son, deliver him from the power of the dog. Save me from the lion's mouth, for thou hast heard me from the horns of the unicorns. Now, Jesus doesn't give up, does he? When Jesus had satisfied justice on the cross, there on that day nearly 2,000 years ago, we're 10 years shy of 2,000 years, you know that, right? The day when Christ was crucified and resurrected, 3 days later, when Jesus had satisfied justice's demands against the sin of the entire world, Sin entered the world by one man. By one man, sin is forgiven through the power of Jesus Christ. When he who knew no sin became sin, and the Father turned his eyes away and judged the Son, the Bible says in Isaiah, he shall see his soul and be satisfied. For Jesus is our propitiation. He is our satisfaction once and for all. Dying once on the cross, the Father is completely satisfied. You know what that means? All the bad things you've ever done in your life that cry out to God that it needs to be just, that He needs to justly get even with you, every bad thing that God's required to get even with you about, Jesus satisfied it already on the cross. He shall look on his soul and be satisfied. That's what a propitiation is. That means he stood in the gap. He stood in between you and God, and he took your beating on himself so that you could be forgiven. And then Jesus, having satisfied it, looked up to heaven and says, "It is finished," because the Son knew at that moment that the Father had been satisfied, that justice itself had been equalized. It was good enough. And because of that, if you're sitting here today and you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, today could be the day of salvation for you, where you could be forgiven once and for all. That transference of God's righteousness can be given to you, and your sins can be washed completely from you. We don't have time to look at it, but in verse 22 and the following of the book, we see the fruition of Messiah's atoning work culminates in hope, resurrection, and eternal life. If you'll read the verses 22 through the rest of the chapter, you will see that it prophesies hope, resurrection, and eternal life. Let's all bow our heads and close our eyes. As our pianist comes and our song leader makes his way to the stage, I want you to take a few moments and reflect on what you've heard, because all these things are important. And in your heart, you may believe they're true, and I hope you do believe they're true, because they are true. But they only benefit you if you take a moment and take that step of faith toward God, and in your heart of hearts, you have a little talk with Jesus yourself. And you reach out to God from your heart and say, "Oh God, I'm a sinner, and I believe everything the preacher said. I believe what the Bible said. Jesus, I believe you died on the cross for me. Lord Jesus, please forgive my sins. I realize that you went through all of that for me, that should have been me on that cross. It should have been me on that cross. And yet you let that man go and you took his punishment, you took his place, and you took my place." From your heart, if you haven't done it already, from your heart, would you reach out to God and receive the gift of eternal life yourself? Ask Jesus to come into your heart and life and make you born again, to make you new. I can't do that for you. No priest, no rabbi, no imam can do that for you. Salvation is a very personal thing. God has already done everything necessary to save your soul. If you were on a deserted island and you had the suitcase wash up onto shore, and in that suitcase there was a bunch of luggage, and then there's a lot of clothes, and in the top of the suitcase, dry and fresh, was a Bible, and you sat there and read that Bible, and there's nobody else on the island, a few monkeys, a few macaws, some fish offshore, some coconuts, a few fruit trees. You're sitting there and you're asking the ultimate questions of life, isolated right there by God. And you begin to read that Bible, and you read it cover to cover, without any other men of God, no rituals. From your heart, you could have a heart-to-heart with God learning about Jesus. And you could read that verse, "To as many as received him, to them gave you the power to become the sons of God. With the words that the Holy Spirit gives you, you can reach out to God yourself and say, Jesus, I believe. I believe in you. I believe you died for me. I believe what you did on the cross can forgive me of all my sins. I'm a sinner and I deserve hell. I know I deserve what you took on your cross. Jesus, please forgive me of my sins. Give me a new life. To as many as received him, to them gave you the power to become the sons of God. Even to them that believe on his name. Oh, yes. Without any special ritual at all, just a heart prayer, your sins can be completely washed away and you can be accepted by God. You might not be on a desert island, but right there in your little corner of the pew, that's your little desert island. Imagine nobody else is around, and just from your heart, you have your little talk with God. You reach out to him, and he's reaching out to you.